Welcome to Pioneer United Methodist Church. I'm Reverend Julie Reinholtz, and this is Reverend Lee Gibbons. In the early morning, Jesus got up and went out to a deserted place to pray. As we turn to you in prayer and praise this morning, gracious God, show us what we are to do.
If you haven't already, my friends, please take a look at this month's newsletter, which was sent out last weekend. There's a lot of important information there from Julie and Pat and the finance team. Give it a look. Today is our monthly food drive. Go Jay Gerbino! So I hope you'll scour the cabinets for unexpired, non-perishable foods and bring them by the parking lot today from 11:45 to 1:30. It's so much fun to see you guys, and this is such good work. Oh, Tuesday. Tuesday is our next Walla Walla Speaks gathering with our special guest, Everett Maroon of Blue Mountain Heart to Heart. Heart to Heart looks out for our marginalized populations and helps prevent the spread of communicable disease and addiction. They're doing some excellent work locally. You've probably seen them mentioned in the Union Bulletin. So please join us on Tuesday night at 6:30 on Zoom. This is a webinar. So while you'll be able to submit written questions, you don't have to worry about being on screen or accidentally pressing the unmute button. I hope you'll be there and tell friends. You can find out more at our website, www.pioneerww.org/WWS. It's a lot of W's. Or on our Facebook page. And the Zoom invite was also in Thursday's connector. It is a blessing to be part of this amazing, active community. That comes from the Spirit, who has called us to worship today. Let's turn now to the business of praising God and hearing the Holy Word. Will you join me in the call to worship? Who made this beautiful day?
We believe God the Creator made this day.
God made this day so we can rest and reflect and enjoy.
God made this day so we can open our eyes and see beauty.
And see pain and see opportunity.
And see hope.
So let us begin this day with our hearts and our eyes open wide.
And let us worship God.
Will you join us in singing our opening hymn, Creating God, Your Fingers Trace?
Trace the bold designs of farthest space.
If you would, please join me in an attitude of prayer. Gracious and holy God, so many people are in need. We pray for them as we pray for ourselves. God, our healer, we pray for those who are sick and for those who look after them. We pray for those who are full of dread and anxiety and for those who carry the word of courage and faith. God, our consoler, we pray for those who are sorrowful and for those who have been and are bereaved. We pray for the weary and for those weighed down by chronic illness, pain, or frailty. We pray for those exhausted by the demands of work or caring for others, and for those who turn to you for new strength. We pray for those who are hungry, those who are without a home, and all those who live under the threat of war. Lord God, hear our prayers. O God, we pray for the concerns and the individuals whom you have placed upon our hearts this day. Hear now, in a moment of silence, the prayers that rise from our midst. Gracious, loving Lord, we ask these things through Christ Jesus, your Son, our Lord, our brother, and our friend. Amen.
My friends. Well, we have five senses, don't we? Five different tools to help us get to know the world around us. Sight, hearing, smell, taste, and which one am I forgetting? Touch. There are so many things to touch and to feel in this great big world, and they feel all sorts of different ways. These marshmallows are squishy. This hat is fuzzy. The sandpaper is rough, and this tape is, can you guess? Sticky. Some things are fun to touch, like sand and bubble wrap. Some things are messy but good, like pizza. Maybe because our sense of taste knows what's coming. Some things are hard or sharp or too hot, and we have to be careful of those things. But some things are wonderful, like kittens, or our favorite blanket, or a nice big hug from a grandparent, or a high five from a best friend. In today's story about Jesus, Jesus visits Simon Peter's mother-in-law, who is very sick with a fever. He goes to her bed. She's so sick she can't even stand up. And he takes hold of her hand. And suddenly, Peter's mother-in-law is up and at him again, as good as new, totally healthy. All it took was the touch of Jesus' hand to make her feel better. Can you even imagine? We know all about illnesses that you can get from touching someone who is ill, but have you ever heard of healing with just one touch? What do you think Jesus' hand felt like in Simon's mother's hand? Strong? Rough from years of work? Could she feel the healing flowing through his hand to her? I wonder. In any case, that touch was so incredible that the story was never forgotten. I hear this story and I think, Jesus would really have his work cut out for him these days. Plenty of sick people who need healing, fevers that need cured. But you know, even though Jesus is in heaven with God now, we believe his touch is still healing the world. There was this amazing Christian woman, her name was Teresa of Avila, who said that Jesus has no body now but ours. Ours are the hands through which he blesses the world. I can't cure a fever with my hands, but I can do other things to help people. I can use my hands, my sense of touch, to do all sorts of good things, even while we're social distancing, if you can believe it. I can help with chores, I can write letters, I can wash my hands to keep germs at bay, I can hug my family. Today, church members will pick through their food at home to find items that they can donate to hungry families. That's a holy kind of touch, I think. Things like this are our way of helping Jesus heal the world. And maybe it'll take more than one set of hands. Maybe it'll take all of our hands working together to keep up the work that Jesus started. Do you think you can help? Do you think you can have hands that heal, that help? Hands that are kind? I think you can. I believe in you. We're sending you all of our love and hope you have a wonderful week. We'll see you next time. Something that comes.
Our scripture reading this morning comes from the Gospel of Mark, chapter 1, verses 29 through 39. After leaving the synagogue, Jesus, James, and John went home with Simon and Andrew. Simon's mother was in bed, sick with a fever, and they told Jesus about her at once. He went to her, took her by the hand, and raised her up. The fever left her, and she served them. That evening at sunset, people brought to Jesus those who were sick or demon-possessed. The whole town gathered near the door. He healed many who were sick with all kinds of diseases, and he threw out many demons. But he didn't let the demons speak because they recognized him. Early in the morning, well before sunrise, Jesus rose and went to a deserted place where he could be alone in prayer. Simon and those with him tracked him down. When they found him, they told him, "Everyone's looking for you." He replied, "Let's head in the other direction to the nearby villages so that I can preach there too. That's why I've come." He traveled throughout Galilee, preaching in their synagogues and throwing out demons. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Many of us remember the famous episode of the television show All in the Family when Sammy Davis Jr. poses for a picture with Archie Bunker. And as the picture is taken, Davis plants a big kiss on Archie's cheek. Or in the movie 42, the story of Jackie Robinson, when Pee-wee Reese comes in, stands beside Jackie, puts his arm around his shoulder, embracing him as a friend and a teammate over the outcries and objections of many racist fans. Today, our scripture covers much ground, everything from Jesus healing Simon's mother-in-law to casting out demons to healing a variety of diseases to praying in a deserted place. For our part, I would like us to focus on the healing of Simon's mother-in-law and the power of touch. Just to review, Jesus leaves the synagogue where he has just healed a man with unclean spirits and goes with the disciples to the house of Simon and Andrew. It seems Simon's mother-in-law is sick. It is not said that she has an impure spirit like the man in the synagogue, but simply a fever. A fever that prevents her from doing her work. She seems impotent. Nobody is helping her. But Jesus grabs her hand firmly to raise her up. The woman is prostrate, and Jesus raises her up. Now, we probably should take a moment to look at the mentality of those who were surrounding the bed at the time. For many who were there, that fever was a demonic force. Our scripture says that the fever left her, just like a person. Rabbis at the time of Jesus spoke of the fever as a game of bones. It is said that that phrase refers to Leviticus 26:16, where it was believed that fevers could sap your energy and destroy one's body. And as we will see on other occasions, Jesus will intervene in a field dominated by evil, death, and illness, and invite each into new life. There is something about the power of human touch. It is personal, it is intimate, and it is healing. In her 20s, the author Sue Monk Kidd was a young nurse, inexperienced in the suffering of others. One afternoon, she witnessed the doctor's grim face as he entered the room of one of her patients. He said, "I'm sorry, Mr. Kelsey, you have cancer, and we should operate right away." When the doctor left, Mr. Kelsey stared out the window in silence, and Sue noticed he was trembling. She wanted to comfort him, but no words came. Instinctively, she placed her hand on his shoulder while rummaging for something to say. And with glistening eyes, the man looked up to her, placed his hand on hers, and whispered, "Thank you." And Sue thought, for what? Could such a small gesture communicate so much? She would never forget the moment she learned not to underestimate the remarkable power of touch. Like Sue Monk Kidd, I suspect most of us take human contact for granted. In fact, some people, say parents of young children, may at times yearn to be left alone. With no one to touch or no one tugging at them, maybe for an hour or maybe even a whole afternoon. But there are others, such as our elderly, who live alone and rarely leave home. In truth, they may go a whole day or even weeks without human touch. And yet our bodies are made for touch, with our skin being our body's largest organ, comprising about 18% of body weight and covering 19 square feet of surface, more or less. And there are as many as 5 million receptors in our skin, touch receptors in our skin, some 3,000 in a single fingertip. The human touch can be a precious and beautiful thing, and to withhold our touch from others can cause pain, isolation, and neglect. I'm reminded of the stories in our current book study, Caste, stories of the Dalit people, the lowest caste of India. These people have been isolated and oppressed, victims of harsh and cruel discrimination for centuries. They have been untouchables. And in 1947, when India gained independence, the Dalits gained some rights, some legal standing, but those rights are rarely upheld unless someone steps in and advocates on a Dalit's behalf. Today, in the midst of COVID, when physical contact has become limited or in many cases eliminated, many of us have developed a condition called touch starvation or touch deprivation. According to Dr. Asim Shah of the Department of Psychology at Baylor College of Medicine, when someone is touch starved, it's like they are starved for food. They want to eat, but they can't. Their psyche and their body want to touch someone, but they can't do it, mostly because of the fear associated with touching, and in this case, the pandemic and catching COVID. Shaw goes on, touch starvation increases stress, depression, anxiety, triggering a cascade of negative physiological effects. The body releases the hormone cortisol as a response to the stress, activating the body's fight or flight response. This cortisol can increase heart rate, blood pressure, respiration, and muscle tension, and can suppress the digestive and immune systems, increasing the risk of infection. Long-term, Shaw added, going on an extended period without positive physical touch can even lead to post-traumatic stress disorder. Articles and experts tell us that nurturing our relationships throughout this global pandemic are challenging, as this is like nothing we have ever gone through before. There are many kinds of intimacy, though, that may be explored during this time. We have to remember there is emotional, physical, intellectual, and spiritual intimacies as well. We might consider how we could shift our focus to other forms of connection to help us tolerate this experience of skin hunger. This could include regular video or phone chats, sharing and expressing how you are feeling, sending letters and care packages to those we love, and talking about non-COVID-related topics, topics that would deepen our knowledge of each other. We do know the time will come when we can touch again. Jesus was never afraid to reach out and touch people, to raise all kinds of people. There were no untouchables to him. No one passed over or left out or rejected. He touched all kinds of people. He touched children as he blessed the little ones. He touched the eyes of the blind, the ears of the deaf, the twisted limbs of the crippled. He touched the ill, the diseased. He touched the sinful, the fallen, the notorious, those who were judged, rejected, and condemned. He touched the invisible, the forgotten, the overlooked who were ignored and neglected. He reached out to outsiders, the forgotten, the strangers who felt isolated and excluded. He touched those who were broken, grieving, those who had no one else and no place to turn. Jesus touched them all. No one was forgotten. No one was excluded or disqualified. Now, Jesus' penchant for human touch was scandalous in his day, offensive and revolutionary. If he had been just a little more sanitary and selective, a little more cautious and callous, if he had just taken care of his own kind, if he had just left well enough alone. But he wouldn't. He didn't. And it cost him his life. And the reason may be Jesus' claim that his touch was God's touch. Could it be the reason for the incarnation? God knew the human need for nearness and touch. And Jesus is the incarnation of God's love, which makes it all more demanding, and if not frightening, to realize that some people, we, you and I, are the only Jesus some people will ever meet. So we who follow Jesus must be willing to reach out, to raise up, to touch all kinds of people. What a power and a privilege to touch with the touch of God. The question I asked this morning is, who are the people that you would lift like Jesus lifted Simon's mother-in-law? Who would you raise up? Who would you touch? And who would you not? Would you raise those who carry a Confederate flag? Those who march under a Nazi flag? What about those who carry the signs of Black Lives Matter? Or would you lift those who wave the rainbow banner? And what about those who kneel in protest before the Star Spangled Banner? Who would you touch? Who would you raise up? I'm not asking you to agree politically or philosophically to condone behavior or beliefs. I'm asking, as a responsible follower of Christ, do we value and respect the worth of every person? Do we lift all people? Do we see all people as touchable, physically or metaphorically? No one was untouchable to Jesus. Now I'm going to ask you to take a moment and look at your hands. And I assume they are pretty familiar to you, every line, every spot, every wrinkle and scar, every vein and bone. Look at your hands and remember that when you gave your heart to Jesus, you gave him your hands as well. Now look again at your hands, for they are God's hands in this world. You and I have the power to bless, to touch, to lift up, and to pray. And we know full well the power is not in us or from us. We know there are other hands, unseen hands, scarred hands, reaching out through our own touch, reaching out to heal and to bless. May it be so.
Thank you, Pastor. In honor of Simon's mother, we lift up the healers today. For the medical staff, from the top doc to the ward clerk to the lab tech to the volunteer at the vaccination clinic, everyone who is putting their own health on the line to restore those who have fallen ill and to help prevent new illness. You are following in the footsteps of our great physician himself, and for you, we are truly grateful. I hope that we as a people can show you our gratitude by continuing to practice good hygiene and social distancing. And even after we've tackled the pandemic to the ground, I pray that we never forget how good you were to us and how worthy you are of our respect. Let us pray for you. Healing God, who soothed fevers and restored sight, raised children from death, cured leprosy, cast out demons, and restored human beings in body, mind, and spirit, we give you thanks for those who share your desire to bring health and wholeness to their neighbors. We know that our medical workers are frayed by overwork, illness, and the constant fear of spreading disease to those they love. We ask your blessing on them. We ask that you give them strength and help them to feel your spirit close to them at all times. Help them bear the sorrow of their work and multiply the joy of it, and teach us to be good patients, good neighbors, good cheerleaders, and good advocates, so that they never feel abandoned by the people they've been called to serve. With grateful, humble hearts, we pray. Amen.
Amen.
This day, we gather together at the table. We hope that you have your elements with you, whatever you have on hand. In our United Methodist tradition, all are invited, for it is not our invitation, but the invitation from Jesus to come, to remember, to be part of the family. Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to God.
Lift up your heads.
We lift them up to God.
Lift up your voices.
We lift them up to God.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to God.
We praise you for your unswerving love for us. Though we are fragile, though we are wounded,
though we are broken, you have never stopped loving us.
And you have never forsaken us. Greater love has no one than this, that they lay down their life for their friends. You take what is broken and you transform it through death and love.
What once was hurt, what once was friction, what left a mark no longer stings, because grace makes beauty out of ugly things.
So we join with the angels singing, holy, holy, holy.
Holy, holy, holy.
Lord God Almighty.
Lord God Almighty.
Heaven and earth are full of your glory.
Heaven and earth are full of your glory.
Hosanna in the highest.
Hosanna in the highest.
In your last meal with your friends before your betrayal, you took the bread and gave thanks. You broke it and shared it by saying, "Take and eat. This is my body broken for you." Christ's body is broken.
We are Christ's body. We are broken. May Christ's broken body nourish you in all the right places. You took the cup of wine, gave thanks, and shared it, saying, "Drink this, my blood shed for you." Christ's body is wounded.
We are Christ's body. We are wounded.
May Christ's wounds heal you in all the right places. Send your Holy Spirit on us.
Heal our brokenness by showing us our place in your community of faith. Great is the mystery of faith.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
This is the table of Christ. Today it is literally made of our brokenness. Holy Spirit, make this bread and wine be the body and blood of Christ for us, a sign that Christ welcomes all as we are. There is no need to pretend and no need to hide. So gather at this table, not because you are whole, but because you recognize your need for healing. Not because you are good enough, but because you recognize these gifts of God. And now with the confidence of the children of God, let us pray the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples, saying, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen."
Please join us now in the sharing and receiving of the elements.
Praise you, feed us with your life, now lead us to
friends, now hear this benediction. Go forth to sing God's good news to others. Go forth knowing that you do not lack anything you need to be a servant of God. Go forth to be that servant for others, to share God's touch, to bless and to pray. You have met God revealed in unexpected places. Go forth to reveal God to others. And may God, the God of touch, timeless gifts, and revelations, go with you on your journey. Amen.
Singing, singing, we are singing.